In this video, I am going to talk about the product rule for random variables, which is also called the chain rule. The basic idea is that sometimes we want to reason about a joint distribution, but we don't have the joint distribution written out as a table, so we need to assemble it from different pieces. So the basic idea is going to be the same as the product rule for events, where, if you remember, we could just rearrange the definition of conditional probability to get that the probability of A intersect B, as in the events A and B both occur, is equal to the probability of A occurring times the probability of B occurring given that A has occurred. So to get the product rule for random variables, the idea is the same. We're going to take the definition of conditional probability for random variables, and we're going to rearrange terms to get the product rule for random variables, where we have the joint distribution is equal to the probability of just y by itself times the probability of x given y. Okay? And, of course, this here holds for all values of x that random variable x can take on, and for all values little y that random variable y can take on. And we are restricting ourselves to when the probability of little y is greater than 0. Okay, otherwise we would be dividing by 0 here. So the main thing here is that if we have the tables for py and px given y, then from these two I can get the joint probability table for px and y. Okay. So I'll say a little bit about what happens when py of little y is equal to 0. And it turns out that in this case, this actually implies that pxy of little x, little y, is also equal to 0. And so the reason why this is true is, if you think about it, if we write out the joint probability table, we have something like this. And we have the different possibilities that x can be, the different possibilities that y can be. And if we're saying that for a specific little y, let's say this column right here, if we're saying that, so py of little y is what we get if we sum these entries, okay? So here, if the sum of these entries is equal to 0, since we know that the entries are non-negative, and their probabilities in particular, then the only way that these could sum to 0 is if all of them are 0. Okay, so if py of little y is equal to 0, then it means that pxy of little x, little y is equal to 0 for all x, as in everything in this column is 0. To say that in terms of equations, we have 0 equals the probability that y is equal to little y. This thing is equal to, by modulization, it's going to be a sum over little x of pxy of little x, little y. Okay, so if this thing here is 0, because these are all non-negative, it implies that these have to be equal to 0. Okay? So, in general, what we have is that pxy of little x little y is going to be equal to py of little y times px given y of x given little y if py of little y is greater than 0, and it's 0 if py of little y is equal to 0. Okay? And an important convention we will be using throughout the class, okay, so this is very important, is that typically in this class we will just write the top case. We will write the joint is equal to py of little y times px given y of little x given little y. We'll write this where we mean that if py of little y is equal to 0, then this whole thing is 0, even though this conditional probability here isn't actually defined. You can think of it as this is a slight abuse of notation. We'll kind of ignore that fact because this whole thing will be 0 anyways. Okay, so we'll have 0 here equals 0, and even though this part is undefined. Okay, and we do this just out of notational convenience because this will keep coming up and we don't want to always write out, oh, there are two cases to consider. Okay, and so I'll just say that it is easy to check that. So we derived the product rule by looking at the definition of conditional probability where we looked at the random variable x given random variable y. If we looked at the other direction around, we would get Pxy of little x little y is equal to Px x little x and Py given x of y given little x. Okay? So both of these are valid ways to write the product rule. Okay? And again, where we are not explicitly writing out the case of in the, here, it would be Px of little x equals 0. Okay, and so an important thing here for both of these is that we are writing the joint distribution as the product of two factors. Okay, later on in the course, we'll see a lot more examples of where we are writing a joint in terms of some kind of factorization. So the last thing I wanted to talk about here is what happens when we have more than two random variables. So, when we have more than two random variables, then what happens is as follows. So, if let's say we have three random variables, x1, x2, and x3, so I'm going to write some commas between them, little x1, little x2, little x3, then what we're going to do is, for example, we can take the last two and treat them as if they were one random variable. Treat as one random variable. And if we do that, then we get, using the product rule, we get P of x1 of little x1 times P of x2, x3 given x1. So little x2, little x3 given x1. All right, so this is just using the product rule once. And then we see that, oh, we can just use the product rule again on this second factor here, where it would become P of x2 given x1, little x2 given little x1, times P of x3 given x1, comma x2. Okay? And so hopefully you see a general pattern, which is that you can think of it like we first introduce random variable x1, and then we introduce random variable x2, conditioned on everything we've introduced so far, which is only x1. And then when we introduce x3, we condition on everything introduced so far, which would be x1 and x2. So the general rule, of course, would be that if we had this going up to xn, okay, here I'm using a capital N not as a random variable, but just capital N for number of random variables, then basically what we would get is these three things multiplied together, and then we keep multiplying until we get to xn given x1 up to xn minus 1. Okay, and little xn, little x1 up to little xn minus 1. Okay, so something to note is that here, earlier I was saying you can think of it as we introduce x1 first and then x2 and so forth. We can actually introduce the random variables in any order. Okay, so when we have n of these random variables, there are n factorial different orderings. So there are n factorial different ways to write out the product rule when we have n random variables. Okay, and so note that we are writing this joint distribution of n random variables as the product of n different factors. You can count up how many factors there are. So again, as I said earlier, we're going to be seeing a lot of this idea of factorization later on in the course.